in our discussion about the lost civilization of Mu, one is struck by the work of a man known as Churchwood, who revolutionized linguistics by finding a common association of word pictures or pictograms between the Mayats, as he called it, the Mayan script, the Egyptian script, and what he found to be the script of the ancient scribes of India and the Far East. And I wanted to ask you, Iris, what you felt would be the importance of looking at Churchwood's work.
Well, I think that the West probably would not have known much about Mu or Lemuria if it hadn't been for Churchwood. He was a colonel in the British military in India, probably about 100 years ago. And he was standing outside a temple and noticed some glyphs day after day, and one of the priests in the temple took a liking to him and took him under his wing and took him down, I think, into the deep underground archives where these ancient clay tablets were, and gave him a new perspective on the actual history of a land that had sunken under the ocean. And from there, Churchwood has a book out. It's very difficult to get today, but it describes the different words and the different writings that came about at that time, and how the landmass sank under a fiery cataclysm. And from there we have the legends of Mu that he gathered together about 100 years ago. And his grandson today has a website and is still continuing the research.
Yes, I was familiar with also the maps that he reconstructed about the movements of peoples, not only from the Middle East across the lands of South America into the Pacific Basin, but he also showed the connection of the Pacific nations moving also in another direction to the New World. I was also struck by the fact that he could take the pictograms, the word pictures, and reconstruct from a deer with his leg extended above really the foundations or the watermark of creation, showing how the whole story of recreation was not localized to one people in the ancient Egyptian or the Greek language, but rather was widespread throughout the world, showing at a very early period of time people had a common cosmology and geology.
And what I think is interesting as well, in terms of our understanding of our past, is that these people were more advanced. They weren't the primitive people with the little arrowheads and things that we sometimes find. These were an advanced culture. These were a culture that knew how to build pyramids, that had the sacred technology. Here you see on Okinawa walls that you can't even get a blade of grass to grow in the middle of, and that's an amazing thing. And you see this also, of course, in the area of Peru. Where did this technology come from? Where did the technology to even build the pyramids come from? There must have been some greater civilization.
What I liked about this documentary on the Temple of Mu is we were able to bring into the documentary discussions by Dr. Sanwell from the Scripps Institute, one of the foremost geologists in the world, who reconstructing the Pacific Basin from NASA satellite photography showed basically there were water lines, there were great fluxes and changes in the Pacific area, whereby the western as well as the eastern land masses as we know them had changed their boundaries.
So many people look at the continent of Mu and they want to place it in the middle of the Pacific Ocean, but what Sanwell said is that's probably not realistic. Where Mu was probably almost right where we're sitting today, and that these islands and even the Japanese islands might have been connected with a much greater continent, and because of the land masses shifting like we've seen recently, that there was this separation, and it was a major separation, a major cataclysm, which caused the sinking of the continents.
And this was the greater work of Dr. Oppenheimer from Oxford University, showing that through his work, we put together the land masses of Indonesia with Thailand, with Malaysia, with
China,
and the southernmost parts of Japan. You have the boundaries of what he constructed as the Mu, or the motherland of a much larger country, connecting so many diverse traditions that would have in the Sanskrit, the pre-Sanskrit dialects of India and Thailand, as well as in the languages of Central and Southern Asia, certain language forms or pictograms that would convey the whole story of the motherland.
The landmass seems to have reached from India, all wrapped around up above the Philippines, and went up to Japan. And in the film, we show how the water level sank in probably three different major waves around 14,000 and 11,000 years ago, where everything seemed to have sunk around that time.
Today we were just at Shuri Castle, and Dr. Kumura was able to show that the foundation of this most important sacred area of Okinawa is identical to a foundation of a landform that he found submerged in the Yonaguni area. And this is a very important tie-in with the structures that did survive on land in various locations. And so we're looking at a vast area connecting the ongoing work in the Philippines, in Thailand, with the Ryukyu Islands, and of course the greater bridges from what we'll call the continent of China, reaching across the Sea of China to Japan itself.
If you overlay a map of the Shuri Castle on top of the monument at Yonaguni, you will find that they're almost exactly the same size, and that the most sacred spots are located in the same position, and the entry is in the same position also. So it's very, very significant that something that's existing today is almost identical to something that submerged 100 feet underwater.
Mayumi, you were at Shuri Castle today. What were your impressions?
I just felt, you know, the governance was one with prayers. That is my most important, you know, experience there. The nature, governance, and prayers were all in one.
Well, that's very interesting. Did you sense that on your own?
Yes.
Oh, well, you know, the gusuku. The gusuku means palace, temple. So all of the gusukus all around Okinawa, they were always built, even though they were royal homes and palaces, they were always areas of great significance for prayer.
Mm. Yes. And also I thought, you know, I consider myself as a, you know, gene-wise, part of me is very close to Nuuk. And I've been wondering why I'm back here now. And I just thought, you know, people of Okinawans or Mu people are very, very peaceful people, loving nature, loving people, loving almost everything.
So Shuri Castle is a sign for us of a peaceful blessing of upon life, upon the waters of creation. It also is a symbol, I believe, of the rediscovery of a much greater historic meaning that has been lost in the oceans of time and space that we're now uncovering. And if I can say this on behalf of our colleague, Dr. Kumura, I feel that the story still continues with other evidences that we have yet to uncover in the Philippines and Indonesia that will link all peoples of the Pacific to this whole new construct of unity. This is something that transcends historic space and time, something that opens the waters to the heavens of the sacred symbol of the Divine Mother, of Mu or Ma, as she is known in so many languages of the world, that precedes even the male priestly tradition as the spark of rediscovering who we are by discovering the Divine Mother within us.
Yeah. Maybe that's why my name is Mayumi.
We thank all of you, and we bless all of you.